So this morning, we started sort of a series that was the last message of the promises of God when we talked about living water, and today we're talking about a living sacrifice. You know, living sacrifice is a term that we gloss over a little bit because it costs you something, right? It's something that the things that you've lived your life with may have to be sacrificed so that you can live. And so I thought that it was appropriate that we talked about living water first. And so just to quickly highlight what I talked about last week, there are kind of three main topics. And I recognized 2 weeks ago, I can't do this any longer without these guys. There's no telling what I'm going to read. So John 4, Jesus is encountered with a Samaritan woman. And, you know, again, we talked about how Samaritans and Jews were not friends. And here he was asking for some water. And they didn't even share instruments to gather the water because they were such mortal enemies. But Jesus, in his conversation with the Samaritan woman, promises that when one drinks living water, they will receive eternal life. And with that, they would never thirst again. Now, that blew the Samaritan woman's mind, right? And so there's this dialogue. He reads her mail about how many husbands she's had, and he clearly had to be something special and went running back into Samaria to say, I think I met the Messiah. Jesus, in chapter 7, John records another event. Now, this is really cool. So Jesus is with a crowd and sort of shouts out, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. And he who believes in me, out of the heart will flow rivers of living water. And so that verse 39, John, who walked with Jesus as a disciple, as he's recording these events, he understands what living water is, but it wasn't until it happened to him. So he comes back and he says, if we're reading it today, we get to know living water is the Holy Spirit. So it says in verse 39, this is the Spirit. But his disciples didn't know, because there was other conversations, obviously, with Jesus, you know, 14, 15, 16, Jesus is talking about his relationship with his dad, and he tells them about the Comforter. But in chapter 7, that happened months before, so they're going, they probably were too scared to ask what it was, honestly, because he was saying a lot of things that, you know, went right over their head. But then we closed with the fulfillment. Jesus said to his apostles, before he ascended, he said he promised them that they would be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So that's where it really began to go, okay, the points are starting to come together. And he said, don't you dare leave Jerusalem or you'll miss it. And so when he said, don't leave, they didn't leave. And they stayed there. But he also said, not only will you get my Spirit, but you're going to get my power. So that Spirit is all-encompassing. It gives us the capacity to live as he lived on the earth. Wow. That's where, when we get this, you know, so many times people have a wrong perspective about the Holy Spirit. His intention was this, that I would send my Spirit to you. And we talked about Jesus himself as he came out of the water. The dove came upon him as the Holy Spirit. He was a man of character. He was a man that lived a sinless life. But he had to be empowered. And he said that in Luke 4. He talked about, because of this power, I can do all of these things. Get the captives free and get the blind to see, the lame to walk. So it is out of that power. We're not talking about any gifting yet. We're just talking about this core package of what you have as the Holy Spirit, living water in you. So here we go. How is it possible to present ourselves to the Heavenly Father as a living sacrifice. Here we go. Romans 12, Paul gives us insight. He challenges us first, and then Scripture gives the backup to tell us how to do this. Paul wrote, "I beseech," which means to urge you, "therefore," and we're going to talk about therefore because that's always important, "brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, a holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service." Verse 2, "and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." So when you look at Scripture, learn to pick out key words. So there is 6 or 8, maybe 10 key words that deserve a deeper dive. Because you may think you understand what that word means, but you'll humanize it, right? We think of what we think about what that word means. But if you don't have the discipline to go, "I'm going to go find a," you know, you can search the name on the internet if you want. I think there's a better versions out there that are more concise. You can get a concordance that you can quickly figure out what living, what's water here. And so I think that when you do this, just always look for keywords. Don't just zip through a scripture. Be disciplined enough to stop, okay? So in this case, sacrifice can be a verb. You sacrifice an animal. Or it can be a noun, a person, place, or thing. So what is it here? Okay, you guys that are new here, it's a noun. Good, okay. So when you think this way, it causes you to go, okay, well, I'm not sacrificing something that's alive. It is an act. It's a thing. It's a person, place, or thing. And that word means it's defined as anything consecrated or made holy and offered to God. Whew, that's a pretty high mark, isn't it? That he's asking us to become a living sacrifice, which means we're made holy. How are we made holy? Through Christ, okay? But we don't have the capacity to lay everything down right off the bat, do we? We have to learn how to lay those things down. Learn how that we become more consecrated. The word is sanctification, to be more like Christ. Living is an adjective. So I was thinking my English teacher would be really proud of me, the fact that I could recognize that. I hope I'm right. Yes, it's an adjective. An adjective is linked to a noun, okay? And so the adjective living means to be active, lively, it means alive, but it also means enduring and engaging. So to be an enduring and engaging sacrifice, that's not one that just has a heartbeat and can breathe. You see, the difference is we start in our journey with the Lord, we get the heartbeat, right? We get that journey part. But it becomes this process where we die to ourselves and more of Him lives in us. And so that living sacrifice becomes this, "I can't do this without you" commitment, this engaged life, that this thing is a priority. So that's why words matter. Now, therefore is an interesting word. We see this frequently. It's there for a reason. But what's interesting is Paul is switching from the first 11 chapters of Romans, which is the doctrine of Christianity. You know, it has to do with sin, the law, you know, the consequences of that. But in chapter 12 and thereafter, he switches. He tells about how do you take what the first 11 chapters and how do you apply it to your life today. So he starts off with a bang, right? Boom! And he says, "By the mercies of God," that's all of the things he described in the first 11 chapters, "you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable, and reasonable service." And we're going to see as we break down some of these words as we move along, you're going to see what he was really after us. He was after us in a good way, okay? All right. So, question, did Christ's sacrifice make the Old Testament sacrifices obsolete? True or false? True. How do we know that? Well, We know from the beginning that that model of sacrifice, when Jesus took his last breath, what happened? The veil was rent. So the old system of sacrifice that required the high priest to go and offer sacrifices to the Lord in the Holy of Holies was removed. So that moment in time, that model, do we have things in the old model that we should learn from? Yes. Okay? But the model of animal sacrifice and a one person petitioning God in the Holy of Holies is done. Okay? In fact, what did Paul write? Likely Paul, most people believe Hebrews, it was written by Paul. So in Hebrews 9, let's see what the Hebrew writer wrote. So Christ has now become what? The high priest over all the things that you have that have come or come to are about to come. So that's interesting because when you look at the word come, it's not just what has come, but will come. Okay? It's this idea that we worship, we think about worship in his presence in the will, but we also need to know that it's now. And the same thing, the come here is not just now, but are to come. He has entered that the greater, more perfect tabernacle in heaven, which was not made by human hands and is not part of this created world. Wow, very clear. There's a new chapter, right? This is the church age. This is the time we're in now. With his own blood, not the blood of goats and calves, he entered the most holy place once for all time and secured our redemption forever. Everybody good? Level set? He's the only way. He's the way, the truth, and the life. What this term, it's interesting when you think about how do you apply that? You know, our existence is made up of our body, our soul, and our spirit. So we are born with an emptiness in our spirit, right? It's void. It's dead. So there has to be something to complete us, right? And the design always was be that his spirit would inhabit that because he was not surprised about Adam's behavior. He knew there was a plan that he designed in eternity for this. So that idea is this living sacrifice, not only on that moment we accepted it as a sacrifice for me, but we live it. We live it in a commitment that it plays out every day. So when he said reasonable service, again, we talked a little bit about that was the fact that in response to the mercies of God, we own our response. We either don't respond, and that's very difficult to walk in a relationship with the Father if you don't respond to his mercies. And that's a part about giving gratitude and thankfulness and things that, you know, we should be just hardwired every day that that's how we approach him. You know, that's what Jesus said. Heavenly Father, creator of heaven and earth. Okay, that's what he said. He wanted us to model that. We honor him, but that we can even go and talk with him because of what Christ did. So this idea of holy and acceptable, to make oneself holy and acceptable. I give you a plan for success. It's on your handout. There's 4 bullet points. If you don't have a handout, raise your hand if you need one. So you don't. Hopefully everybody that wanted one got one. So this is the plan to become holy and acceptable, consecrated, okay? To be able to enter into his mercies and celebrate them. Our bodies are presented in worship. Who we are, our entire entity, our mind, will, and emotions, we are to present ourselves in honor and worship to him. That's why you have to practice during the week. It's hard to come kind of, to be an NFL player, they practice 2 or 3 times a day, right? You know, so the pass, they know exactly what route to run. Well, that's the same concept, is we should practice worshiping alone or with our family. Because then when you get here, it doesn't feel so weird or uncomfortable. What is all this going on here? So that's why it needs to become a daily habit, that we practice this. And you know what? It may last 5 minutes. It may last 5 hours. That's between you and the Lord. But I promise you, when you do it regularly, it'll be so seamless. You'll be driving the car and worshiping even with your eyes open, hopefully. Number two, our reasoning, the reasons for our goal of being holy and acceptable is being responsive to the Word of God, the truth. So if we don't recognize, and the second habit we talk about is being in the Word. You know, this is what we're doing today. We're studying the Word. We're teasing out the Word and its meaning. But what do you do with the Word? You know, people will read a Bible plan, and they've gone through the whole Bible in a year. Well, what do they do with that? You know, how was that became bread of life? How did that become a standard of truth of how we behave and how we treat each other? Thirdly, our emotions. How many of you have emotions? How many times are they your friend? You know, that's why the one emotion that we should be hardwired is love, right? If we love the way this book tells us to love, that other thing can be a non-entity, I promise you. Because you think about the other person. You think about how do we represent what Jesus did. So our emotions are awakened to what? His loving kindness and not the world's distress. You know, if we woke up, you know, in this state of mind of, man, there's such peace. You know I have big meetings. I know I have to drive an hour to work. You know, all of these things that the world wants to deliver to us or deal us. But having that soul, that mind, will, and emotions that focus on his loving kindness, because none of this is possible without him. And finally, the really root of success is acknowledging that the Holy Spirit will revive and renew your soul. So if you think about in our life, you have those three domains. I have this graphic. I decided not to put it in, but you have the three domains, the body, the soul, and the spirit. There's a throne above the soul. When you're not in Christ, who sits on that throne? You. When you come into Christ, you have this new domain, the spirit domain is full of him. And he desires to train you and mold you and direct you through the word, through communication with the Father, through prayer. And his place is now where? He sits on your throne. And but you know, in this early phase of life, you're going back and forth. You know, it's hard to keep him on the throne, right? But if we follow this plan, there's a plan, there's action items that you should take to keep him on the throne of your life. And so if you look at that and think about this idea of acknowledging that I can't do this without the power of the Holy Spirit. And that means that there is something palpable in you that when you ask the Father to send the Son and gave your heart to Christ, there's a palpable difference. Sometimes you don't really know what it is. And that's the role of a disciple maker, to help you to understand that and develop that spirit of the living God inside of you. All right. Also, the next kind of component of this is we have to deal with sin, and we don't want sin to be in charge, i.e. myself sitting on the throne, okay? Instead, when we give ourselves completely to God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit on that throne, things happen. Romans 6, this is what Paul again says. This is part of the mercies of God. He's telling us, do not let sin control the way you live. Do not give in to sinful desires. Do not let any part of your body become an instrument of evil to serve sin. Instead, give yourselves completely to God, for you were dead, but now you have new life. He's talking about the spirit man. The spirit man was dead, now the spirit man is alive. So use your whole body as an instrument to do what is right for the glory of God. Sin is no longer your master, for you no longer live under the requirements of the law. That's part of what Paul speaks about in the first 11 chapters of Romans. Instead, you live under the freedom of God's grace. That's a pretty good guarantee. That's a guarantee you can take and live and give respect to. But here's the real tug, right? There's a tug of war. How many of you'd have a tug of war every day? Who's in charge, right? You know, I mean, we have a few people that are honest, you know. The rest of you are nodding in your, you know, imagination. You're nodding, which is fine. One day you'll nod, you know, without worrying about what other people think, you know, because we're all in the same boat, right? We struggle with the same battles, this tug of war, you know. And it's that, it's recognition of that and bringing that out from the sort of the silent, the shadows to say, okay, I know what's going on right now. You know, I'm in this situation because this part of me is not where it needs to be. And, you know, it's okay to talk to yourself. Self-talk is a good thing. You know, sometimes people think that, now, if you say it in public and you're talking to yourself, maybe be careful with that because, you know, they may call the loony bin, you know. So the truth is self-talk is healthy. And when you recognize things that are not going well, wow, you can go to the Lord and say, this is, Father, I need help with this. Because guess what? He will always answer that appeal for help. Sometimes he has to connect another dot. It has to come through somebody else, okay? So that's how incredibly he loves us. He has this whole domain of fellow believers, and you have a need, and you petition him. Sometimes he'll answer it just directly because it's something really intimate. But most of the time, he has another cog that's been assigned to that need. And that's why you have to have a body that lives together and does community together. Because you need people that you trust around you, right? Because that trust then builds fellowship. And then it becomes this source of alignment and power. Because there's synergy in how people treat each other and how we respect what the Word says. All right, Romans 8. Therefore, dear brothers and sisters, you have no obligation to do what your sinful nature urges you to do. It's a pretty good one to read, right? For if you live by its dictates, or if it's dictating your behavior, you will die. But if through the power of the Spirit you put to death the deeds of your sinful nature, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. You know, this idea that we're not obligated to our desires, you know, we can say, well, I really want this. Okay, some of the things you want are not good for you. And some of the things you desire, you know, that we use the lens of the world, right? And there are things that, well, that's not evil. But if it's not a desire that brings forth the kingdom of God in you, you need to have that ability to say, stop spending time desiring something that's not for me. We get a lot of time that we spend chasing after things that are not evil, they're not bad, but they're not the things that he desires for us because there are other things. He has a whole treasure chest of things specifically for us. You know, it's how this uniqueness of the relationship with the Father is. So when God has complete control, we can then live a new life, which is a sacrifice life, a life that is a living sacrifice. This last part is, do not be conformed, but transformed. You know, that's a quick one that we read through in Romans 1, verse 2. Do not be conformed, but be transformed. But what does that look like? So we have to know where we are starting as a dead spirit, okay? Everybody starts at the same place. 1 John 2:15. So this is where the root of the dead spirit is, okay? Do not love the world nor the things it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. Now, we can all say, well, I don't really love the world. There are parts of it that we probably love and we don't know. We don't recognize. But that's between you and the Lord and the Holy Spirit to show that. But there are things in our life that we should, that are not part of loving God. Verse 16, for the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure, a craving for everything we see. Well, that would account for all of us, right? We just talked about that vision of the world, and there are things in it that we crave, and pride in our achievements and possessions. These are not from the Father, but are from the world. And this world is fading away, along with everything that people crave. but anyone who does what pleases God will live forever. That's an interesting sort of line in the sand, right? I mean, that's one I have asked about. Can you get some clarity on that one? Because it's about this journey of life, right? And there are times clearly that I wasn't doing things that pleased God, but I think he still had my heart, okay? So you're not under condemnation, okay? But we just need to recognize that. There are seasons where we're not doing what the Father would have us do. But that's how we talk about it, talk to ourselves, and figure out what the Word, how do we get back on track? Because it's the recovery that matters, right? You know, if you don't experience, it's just kind of like I was thinking about the Old Testament to tell us how much we need a Savior, the sin. It's the same principle today. We need to recognize our sin, how much we need a Savior. It's the same as the Old Testament taught us the same thing. And it's not a one and done, right? You know, we have to continue to seek more of him, to be more like him. But if you don't see sin, it's hard to know you need more of him. So you see what I mean? This is not about condemnation. It's about learning to grow in this relationship. Okay. So I'm going to invite the worship team to come back up as we kind of close this part of our word. Conforming is loving the world. Transforming is loving the Father. Because he was never expecting us to be of this world. He wanted us always to be of his kingdom. We're a living sacrifice when we're not conformed. It's the will of God for every believer to be a living sacrifice. And the Word of God administered by the Holy Spirit. That's the only way you can understand this book, is that the Holy Spirit highlights it for you. I know that I can remember reading the Bible and what in the world was it saying? But I knew I needed to read it. But until I adopted the understanding that when I came to Christ, I had the Holy Spirit as my teacher, I like highlighting things. I like the fact that the Holy Spirit highlights things for me because I really sometimes need that. I don't always see that. And so it is the key. The Word of God coupled with the Holy Spirit transforms a life that is a living sacrifice because we can only sacrifice ourselves because of the Holy Spirit. You know, I was thinking about this image I found. There's a message coming about altars that the Lord's going to have me teach here in a few weeks. But, you know, every one of us have an altar in our soul. There's this interface between darkness and light. This is this battle that we are up against all the time, okay? And I believe that the altar is a place where you sacrifice things in your life. The altar is a place where you reflect on celebrations, you know. So you look at all the different ways you see the Old Testament patriarchs who would build altars. Noah built an altar. He's going, I have no idea why you chose me, but they were celebrating the fact that there they were, and then God says, look, I'm going to give you a rainbow to make sure I'm putting an exclamation point on that. I won't do that again. But it was all around this altar experience and the thankfulness of Noah and his family. So altars have many reasons, many things, and we refer to this here, but you can have your own place at home where you do this. And I would encourage you to have a place that you sort of put a stake in the ground, metaphorically. This is a place where I'm going to come and bring the Lord honor and lay things down and walk in truth. And so I think that kneeling is an interesting thing in Scripture. You know, it's today, you know, if you kneel, you know, typically, where do you see that today? It's still in the old school in England, you know, if they approach the queen or king, they kneel. You know, you see kneeling in the Catholic Church. You know, they bring honor and they kneel to the priest that's administering. You know, kneeling is a thing that's not a part of typically what we think about in the evangelical circles. But I would just challenge you that this is that whole idea of being a living sacrifice, that things in the natural can be expressions of things in the spirit. And so, wow. You know, I think the Lord just had me write this scripture down, and maybe it's for someone. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. For some of you here, that was given to me for someone here. Because you can hear all this, but there's no power. There's no capacity to make the necessary changes, the things you want to do and need to do. So sometimes there's a need to say, you know what? I don't know what I did before, but I got to do it right now. Because this is the scripture for you. Confess your sins. He is faithful to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So if you don't mind standing, we're going to have some time of worship together. Our kids are now with us, and we're going to have some time of worship. And I want to invite you and invite our team to come forward. You know, think about things that you need to sacrifice today. Some things, I can tell you, one of the number one things you have to sacrifice is unforgiveness. That will put you in lockdown, I promise you. It's hard to live a life of joy and peace and comfort. So you don't necessarily have to have someone pray with you, but have them come up here. If you want to just pray on your own, please do that. But this is a time to reflect on this idea. What do I need to sacrifice? Do I have a life that's already born again? Is it a life that's invigorated and under this tutorage of the Holy Spirit? So, Father God, we just thank you that your word gives us all the things we need. We don't need a lot of commentary. We just need to know what your word says and follow it and be directed by it. So, Lord God, we thank you for that today, that your words, your exhortations through Scripture, it's so clear. It just writes it out for us. And, you know, so many times we're looking for something written in the sky. We just need to pick this book up and see what you already wrote. So, Father, thank you for that. And so I just ask that as we engage in a time of witnessing your might and power, that we invite you to move in the hearts of men and women and children in this room. If they're struggling with something, please let us pray. If you want to celebrate a victory, celebrate it before the Lord. And Father God, we love you, we thank you, and we pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
And if you want to come up here and kneel at the altar, just feel free to come up anytime as we are ministering.
Okay, buddy, no worries, no worries, no worries.
Thank you. to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me. Lead me to the cross. That's
all the kids and their parents, if you'll come with them, please. Come up here. Because this is a holy moment for them, because they have the backing of their parents and this congregation. Because we send these young warriors into a battle, and they need to be covered and protected. Come on up here a little closer. Y'all press in, because I want those that don't have kids to get comfortable and come around. We're going to create a wall, okay? A metaphorical wall that the body of Christ commits to lifting these kids up and people that are in your family, because they're stepping into a war zone, okay? But you know what? The love of God will be with them and protect them. And they're going to learn skills, but more importantly, the power. Because the world has no weapon that can be formed against the Spirit of God. And so today, that's what we're going to pray for. Just like we talked about, to have a relationship with the Father, you have to have the Holy Spirit. And so today, many of these kids, some of which have been baptized already, made a commitment of faith. Others that will come soon. So I would ask you just to be all around, wherever you are, just put your hands out toward these kids and their parents. Just make sure you're touching them. Go back over there. Go with your dad and your grandpa. Why don't you go over there and get with them? Okay. So Heavenly Father, we come before you today. Father God, we're going to anoint these kids with some oil today, because they need a picture of the fact that you're with them, and that the presence and just the requirement of this body to lift them up, Father God. So Lord God, I just pray a blessing on these children, Lord God, that Lord God, the power of God that was promised by Jesus to his disciples, that they would come upon them and give them everything that they need. And Father God, we just pray for the schools, that Lord God, the teachers would be ever committed to hold the standard of truth and righteousness. Father God, we ask that you build a wall around them, that you protect them from all of the things that the world would like to disrupt in their life. And Father God, we thank you for them, because I know them, I've taught them, I've watched them. I know that they have your heart, Lord God. Many of them have already made a commitment, Father God, that Lord God, that others will seek you first. And Holy Spirit, that you would come, that they would palpable, feel that presence, Lord God, and that they would know that you're present in them. And that when the bullies try to stand up, that you will have them stand up in faith and walk away and not be manipulated or spoken against. And Father God, we just pray for these precious children, that Lord God, they are yours. And Father God, they may, in the journey of figuring this out, Lord God, but Lord God, they have parents and grandparents around them that are here to stand on guard, to be watchmen over these precious children. Intercede for them on a daily basis, because they need it. They need your presence. They need your covering. They need your anointing. That Father God, I just pray that peace would be upon them, that the enemy has no authority to come against these precious kids. And Lord God, that you are ever with them as they ride the bus, as they go to recess. Lord God, that you're with them everywhere. You're with them, Father God. Lord, I just bless them, Lord God. Thank you for them. Thank you for this precious young man, that you love him, you adore him, you see him in a healed state, Father God, that he will be restored fully and completely, Lord God, that, Lord God, he will learn the things that you have for him to learn. And this precious girl, Lord God, I just speak blessings over her. She's a helpmate. She's a servant. She has a desire to love others, Father God. Grow that in her. And Holy Spirit, just fill her, Lord God. So, Father God, for these precious kids over here, just want to pray for them. I love these guys. They have such a smile, such a joy in their heart that, Lord God, you're going to give them protection. You're going to wrap your presence around them, and the Holy Spirit would be their guide. It would be the thing that they lean to, that they don't trust the things of the world, the temptations and the distress, that, Father God, that they'll be protected. And Father, I pray for Leah, Father, right now, Lord God, that you'd be with her. She's in a tough time of life with the season of the kids around her, and there's so much craziness going on, but Lord, let her see you. Let her see you in the protection that you provide and the training that you provide. And Holy Spirit, just come upon her as well, Lord God, that she would be walking strength and confidence that the world cannot harm her. And Father God, we thank you. And Father, we pray for every parent that's here today, Lord God. Give them wisdom. Give them strength. Give them authority that you have empowered upon them to cover these precious kids. Because, Father God, they go into a battle, but the battle is yours. And we're reminded of those principles. Say those scriptures over your kids. Encourage them. Speak to them. Have a devotion with them every day. Don't lose those moments, because those words that you'll pray over, those scriptures that you'll read, will empower their spirit. And the Holy Spirit will be the teacher. They'll teach them the things that you have shared with them. So, Father God, we just lift your name on high. We thank you for that the family of God can come together and do business, do the King's business. And this is the King's business. This is what we're to be about. And, Lord, we thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you came in power. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you will protect these kids. And we're standing, every one of them, under that authority. So we pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our King. Amen and amen. Yeah, you can just do it there.
This is for the parents. What just happened right here is so important. You don't realize the enemy is so real out there, and it's a lot stronger than it has been. It's getting stronger, but God is bringing up an army that is even stronger. And here's the seriousness of this. I read a book about the witch that switched. When she was in junior high, she would see these two beautiful young girls going from their house to their school. She made a plan. She wanted to get those girls, compromise those girls. And she tried for years and years. And she was a practicing witch. And here's what happened. She could never touch those kids. When she went back to the house where those kids lived and asked the mother, "I tried to get your kids. I tried to get your daughters to compromise them. And guess what happened?" She said, "You couldn't, because I pled the blood of Jesus Christ upon those kids. Every single day I prayed over those kids. I lifted them up. I put a hedge of protection around them in the name of Jesus, and I broke every assignment of the enemy possible in the name of Jesus. And I guarantee you, he cannot touch your children if you put that on them every single day." Guess what? That witch switched. And she became a born-again, spirit-filled Christian because it's a process. What you do today for these kids will live on and on and on. You can't stop the power of God. And when you break the assignments of the enemy over your family, you can't, you cannot lose. You can't lose. In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
God bless you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Wow. So as we sort of close with the worship, if you, your kids need school supplies, Cheryl and her team have put together some supplies up here. So visit with her. You know, we have different things. And if you have things that you really need that you just haven't been able to get for your kids, let Cheryl know and we'll find a way to get those to you. Okay. All right. I'm going to turn it over to our team as we close out.
Lead me to the cross where your
stand up there.
That I can't contain and I can't control. I want.